There is no words. There are easy songs on this one.
Good morning and happy Sabbath to you all. I'd like to welcome you to Sabbath School today. We're a group of gymnastics type people. And I say type people because we do more than just gymnastics. We're students. I'm actually one of the staff members at Great Lakes. And it's our privilege to be here. We're so thankful for the generosity and the welcoming spirit from the Papa Seventh-day Adventist Church. We're blessed. Are you blessed this morning? Amen. Amen. Well, let's join together in singing some worship songs this morning as things go flying about over there. This morning's Sabbath School songs that we'd like to do with you today are kind of familiar ones, maybe from your primary school days, if you can remember that far back, or maybe you're still in them. But pretty much all of these are in the He Is Our Song book, which I know you don't have in front of you, but they're ones that'll come right back to your memory pretty quickly. We'd like to start with a very well-known song, Jesus Loves Me.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong, they are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. Jesus loved me, He who died, heaven's gates to open wide. He will wash away my sin, let His little child come in. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus, take this heart of mine, make it pure and wholly thine. On the cross You died for me, I will
Is there a way that you felt Jesus' love this week? If there is, why don't you just tell us? Tell us about it. How have you felt Jesus' love this week? Yes, right here. Amen. Although I do hear that some snow is on its way tonight, huh? Okay, all right. Amen. Praise the Lord for good weather. The sunshine is out, and I know that always makes me feel better. Anyone else? How do you know Jesus loves you based on this week? What has He done for you? Excuse me? He provides, yes. Every breath we take is a gift from God. And God, you know, being in control, he could cease that. But He loves us and He wants us to live fully. And so life is a wonderful gift from God. Let's now sing the song, Seek Ye First, the Kingdom of God.
The kingdom of God and His righteousness.
Last song we want to sing this morning with you in our Sabbath school worship portion is Alleluia. If you want to join with us in standing as we sing this to the Almighty God, the creator of the universe, the one who came and bled and died so he could be your pardon and my pardon, and so that he could stand between us and the Father, and we could be seen through the righteous blood of Jesus. Alleluia to our King.
My Savior, I praise the Lord.
He is coming.
He is coming.
Hear the voices sing alleluia.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that we get to be here at this church and get to learn you better every day. Lord, thank you that it's Sabbath, and please help the sermon and bless it, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Happy Sabbath. I'd like to welcome you all to church today. Hope you have a good time and that you're blessed.
Happy Sabbath. We are part of GLAZ, which is one of many witnessing groups. We're the Aerokhanas. Other witnessing opportunities the school has is we have a wonderful music program. We have many different groups. We have a choir, we have a chambers, which is more of an advanced choir, we have a bell choir, we have a string ensemble, we have a wind symphony, we have brass instruments, and they're very beautiful to listen to. They have many performances, and they're a real blessing. They too are just like us and bless many other churches. We also have a new thing we started every one Tuesday out of every month. The whole school goes into the community, and we outreach to people, we help them with service, and it's just a real blessing. So as you see, we're just a small part of our school's witnessing program. But some of the things we do are weekend tours, which generally start with a passion play on Friday night, like some of you may have seen last night. And then we come to church, and we do Sabbath school and church, and we hope to be a real blessing. And we're just really glad to see all of you here today. Normally, there's a Vespers later that night, and then it's followed up with a Saturday night gymnastics program. So gymnastics is only just even a small part of what our team is about. Our team is about Christ, amen? And we try to remember that. Other things we do throughout the year is a week of prayer tour to a sister academy, and there will be morning and evening services that actually are put on by us. We have a bunch of our team members go up and just give little sermons, and it's just a really big blessing. And Thursday night, we do a passion play, and then generally afterwards, we have a time for prayer, and many students will come to that, and just it's a big blessing. Friday night, there's an agape feast, and people can just share personal experiences that they've had with Christ, and it's an amazing time. Saturday, we once again do church and Sabbath school, and another Vespers, and we ended off with a gymnastics program. Other things we do are a long tour, which we call Listen America. We take a week off, and we go to a bunch of public schools, and we talk about healthy living, since we're not allowed to talk to them directly about Jesus. And we try and witness to them just how we live, that there's a better way out there. And I've heard multiple stories that coaches told me where teachers will come up and say, there's something different about your kids. They're not like other groups that we've had come and watched. There's something different with your kids. And so they can see Jesus through us. And that's just really a big blessing. And so I just wanted to tell you about a little about what we do, and hope you have a rest. I hope the rest of your Sabbath is really good.
Wife, where's my lunch?
Go make your own lunch. I've been trying to fix the children for
I work.
School.
I have to work. I don't have time for lunch. You should be doing that
Go
for me.
Go buy Taco Bell for all I
No. Care. You. Why do I have to do everything in the house? I work hard, and I get things done. And what do? Nothing.
I watch the children.
No.
Do you see them doing your hair?
So basically, prayer has an effect. Even if you don't see it, it does. In this case, you saw it, I hope. But even if you don't think it does, it does. So just pray often, all the time.
Blessed are you as you weep on your knees, with perfume and tears washing over my feet. Blessed are you, beggar, hopeless and blind, calling for mercy when I'm passing by. And blessed are you, shaking your head at two tiny fish and some bread. Blessed are you as you tremble and wait for the first stone thrown at your sinful disgrace. Tell me your story. Show me your wounds. And I'll show you what love sees. Love looks at you. Hand me the pieces, broken and bruised, and I'll show you what love sees. Love sees you. Walking on waves to find yourself sinking when you look away. Blessed are you, leper, standing alone. The fear on their faces is all you have known. And blessed are you, lonely widow, who gave your last tiny coin to Yahweh. Blessed are you with your silver and lies, kissing the one who's saving your life. Tell me your story. Show me your wounds, and I'll show you what love sees when love looks at you. Hand me the pieces, broken and bruised, and I'll show you what love sees when love sees you. Your mother's womb, I see the day that I fell in love with you. I see your tomorrows, nothing left to chance, and I see my father's fingerprints. I see your story, I see my name written on every beautiful page. You see the struggle, you see the shame, and I see for your story. I came for your wounds, to show you what love sees when I see you. Hand me the pieces, broken and bruised, and I'll show you what love sees.
All right, Jesus, man, that was a sweet walk. You see all those deer? That was so cool. They came right up to us, and they ate right out of our hands. That was pretty legit. I was like, man, that's so much fun. And yeah, it's cool. So, you know what? I was thinking about it, and I really want you to, like, be close to me. I want you to, like, be involved in every part of my life. Like, could you do that? Would you be there? Yeah?
Of course I'll be there for you.
All right, cool. So I was just like, oh, wait, actually, I got a text. 1 second. You see that picture? You get it. That's pretty. Oh, here's another one. Oh, you wouldn't want to see that. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Jesus. I don't think you'd. No, you don't. This is awkward. Hey, let's look at some magazines real quick. You know, and like pass the time a little bit. I have this like, here. Let me see here. Oh, Backpacker. Yeah, it's a pretty cool magazine. Oh, look at those boots. Yeah, and then oh, here's the other one. Oh, I didn't even know I had that here. I'm sorry, Jesus. But I really want you to be involved in my life, though. I really want you to be close to me. But, like, this is awkward. Hey, let's watch some TV. Let's watch some TV here. Come sit down. All right. Phineas and Ferb. Let me change the channel. I'm sorry, Jesus. Let me turn that off. Oh, man, I'm sorry, Jesus. I keep on like, I feel like I'm insulting you in like my home, but like, I want you to be by me.
I want to be with you.
But I just can't. You know what? Never mind, Jesus. I don't. You know, I can't. I can't do it. I don't. I can't keep on messing up in front of you. I don't like this.
I want to be with you.
Andrew. No, really, stay back. No, I can't handle this. No.
Sabbath. The scripture reading for today is found in Proverbs 10:6. Once again, Proverbs 10:6. Okay. Blessings are on the head of the righteous, but violence covers the mouth of the wicked.
Good morning. We're happy to be here with you. Actually, one of my favorite things to do is actually leading out in Sabbath school, because I learn a lot of things, and I really like to talk a lot. So it's a win-win situation. Oh, so this week's Sabbath school, if you had studied it, or from what we're going to talk about today, is the blessings of the righteous. As this lesson suggests, this lesson looks at the blessings of the righteous. And most of our verses that we're going to be looking at are in the book of Proverbs. And the book of Proverbs is telling us that wisdom is righteousness, and righteousness means to walk according to God's commands, like to walk in faith with Him and have obedience to what the Lord has called us to do.
Righteousness is hostilic. Can I please have a volunteer to read Proverbs 10, verse 1 through 7? Proverbs 10, verse 1 through 7.
And we have mics roaming around, so if you're a quiet, more quiet talker, we have mics for you.
These are the wise words of Solomon. Wise children make their father happy, but foolish children make their mother sad. Riches gotten by doing wrong have no value, but right living will save you from death. The Lord does not let good people go hungry, but He keeps evil people from getting what they want. A lazy person will end up poor, but a hard worker will become rich. Those who gather crops on time are wise, but those who sleep through the harvest are a disgrace. Good people will have rich blessings, but the wicked will be overwhelmed by violence. Good people will be remembered as a blessing, but evil people will soon be forgotten.
So, what various principles about life and faith are revealed here? What various principles about life and faith are revealed here? Well, there's a story about a man in a boat who began to drill a hole under his feet where he sat. When the people in the boat demanded that he stop, he responded, "This is none of your business. This is my place." This absurd response is often the excuse used by the sinner to justify his or her behavior. "This is my life. It has nothing to do with you." But of course, we know that whatever we do and say affects us, not only us, but everybody around us.
And also, like, along with that, I think especially one thing when I was reading through this I thought about, I think big decisions that we make, especially as younger people, and I'm sure you older adults in here, when you were younger, you made decisions, and they greatly affect your parents a lot, you know, because your parents love you a lot. And when you make decisions, it really does affect them, because it hurts them, too, when you make bad choices about certain things, either if it comes to academics, or if it's just a really bad choice that has really bad consequences, you know, stuff like going to jail and stuff like that. You know, it does affect people who you love, especially.
The principle of unity between the spiritual moral life and the physical material life is dealt with in Proverbs 10, verse 3 through 5. And it says, he read it, but "The Lord will not allow the righteous soul to famish, but He cast away the desire of the wicked. He who has a slack hand becomes poor, but the hand of the diligent makes rich. The main idea is that wickedness or moral deficiency does not pay, even if one is rich. The second, and second, that righteousness is also always rewarding in one way or another, even if one is poor. In Proverbs 10, 6 through 7, we see here an earlier expression of what Jesus said about lust is adultery and hatred akin to murder. Hiding our hatred behind our words doesn't always work either. Wicked thoughts are often betrayed in our body language and the tone of our voice. The best way to start a good and healthy relationship with other people is remembering that well-known verse found in Leviticus 19:18, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And, yeah.
So as she was saying, like, when you make decisions, they do affect other people, you know? So think about, you know, what kind of decisions are you making in your life right now, and how will they affect other people? Decisions, you know, I thought about as I was reading through this is, like, since I'm a senior, I get to go off to college next year, and, like, what I do for my career will affect other people, you know? Like, either what I want to be or what kind of job I get, you know, how will it affect my family and how will it affect my relationship with God? So I think I try and think about those things. And another thing, too, is I think a lot of us, at least younger kids and maybe some adults, are, like, looking for jobs. For me this summer, when I was looking for a job, I was, like, trying to think in... Along with, you know, summer camps being good because a lot of our Adventist colleges help, you know, match what you make, which is really helpful, especially for those of us, you know, that need a little extra money here and there, and it helps a lot. And I feel like, you know, by working at a summer camp for myself and how it affects other people is so that I can be in, like, a good environment, and yeah. Something else our lesson talks about people who are righteous, you know, is our mouth. You know, our mouth is the most important organ in the book of Proverbs. And actually, something I found interesting as I was reading, the word mouth is used 50 times in Proverbs. The word lips is used 41 times, and the word tongue is used 19 times. So that's quite a significant number of times it is used. So our words are very powerful. We can either use them for good or for evil. And the tongue, like our tongue and like how we speak, can either be a really good gift that we have, like to bless others, or it can be a really bad gift, and it can be used for evil if we try and put down others or if we don't watch what we say, because it affects other people quite a bit. Can we have somebody read Proverbs 10, 11 through 14? Again, that is Proverbs 10, 11 to 14.
He that winks with the eye causes sorrow, but a prating fool shall fall. The mouth of the righteous man is a well of life, but violence covers the mouth of the wicked. Hatred stirs up strife, but love covers all sin. In the lips of him that has understanding, wisdom is found, but a rod is for the back of him that is void of understanding.
Thank you. So as we were reading this, what is the contrast between how the righteous people speak and how the fool speaks? What kind of contrast was it making? Anyone have any comments?
It seems to be saying that, like, kind of like righteous people kind of like lift people up. It says it's a well of life, and that so when they talk, like, they're just like uplifting people, and the wicked people are just kind of like tearing others down.
She made a good point there. In Proverbs 10:11, it talks about the well of life, and this symbolically refers to the qualities of wisdom. And it also is referenced to, like, how God is, like, our source of life. So, like, when we speak and we use our mouth, we should try and be getting our wisdom and our thoughts and our words from God, you know, who is our source of life. So, like, as you would get water from a well, you, like, want to get your words from God, if you can understand that analogy. What characterizes this mouth is the positive gift of life. This quality tells us what the proper function of the mouth should be. You know, it should be used for good and not for evil, a source of life and not death, because the mouth definitely can generate life, but it can also generate death, which is very sad, but it happens. And also something else, too, I found is kind of it's along the same lines, but it's a different point. I never really thought about it. Remember, too, that it was through speech that God, you know, created this word, but, you know, by the word of his power, he created the earth and whatnot. And so just as, like, God created the heavens and the earth, we should also try and create new feelings and things and people, you know. We should also, we should serve only for creative purposes, you know. You know, create a better life in somebody or create a better feeling in somebody, because a lot of, just maybe one comment, like, either when you go up to a lady and you're like, oh, I really like your scarf today, or I really like your outfit, like, just one little comment can, like, brighten a whole person's day, or even a smile, and that's not even words, but people know just by how you smile. So consider carefully how incredibly powerful your words are. With your words, you can fill people with self-confidence, cheer, and hope, or you can break them down and damage them as surely as if you attack them physically. You know, how careful are you as you wield the power of your tongue? Something that I struggle with sometimes is, like, I'm a pretty strong-willed person, and sometimes I don't exactly think before I speak. I'm pretty good about it for the most part, but sometimes I don't think before I speak, and I don't think how maybe what I say can affect other people. Because for my personality, since, like, I kind of always have something to say, whether it's, like, a good or bad thing, it can be a blessing, but it can also be a curse, and sometimes I don't really think before I say things, and, I lost my train of thought. Yeah, so as I was saying, it can either be a curse or a blessing, so.
Can someone please read Proverbs 11, verse 3?
Again, that's Proverbs 11, verse 3.
The integrity of the upright will guide them, but the perversity of the unfaithful will destroy them.
In this verse, what examples have you seen or heard about which the spiritual truth has been revealed? What examples have you seen or heard in which the spiritual truth has been revealed?
Well, so for Sabbath School, we like to think of this as more of a discussion, and we're up here leading the discussion, so.
Excuse me, but I think we see that every day in life. People who other people don't trust are not held in the same esteem as those who have integrity, who are known to be honest.
My wife had an experience yesterday. She was cutting a gentleman's hair he goes to the evangelical church in St. Joe, and he was in there, and he's been sharing with her when she cuts her hair how he's actually took some classes from Andrews University, and the principal's wife was teaching the class. And this guy is the type of guy that checks everything out. He's a math teacher. Well, he had one of the leaders in his Sabbath school class last week challenge saying, you will never have a Seventh-day Adventist ever say this. And for some reason, he's been kind of pointing and picking on us as a church. And the crazy thing is he went back and discovered that what he said was absolutely incorrect. That when he searched back, it was actually, he found something from James White that stated that we do believe what he was saying we don't believe in the Lord. And what so he took that, brought it to his church, to the gentleman, and the gentleman wouldn't even read it, didn't want to know what the truth is. That happens every day. A lot of times we like to believe, and we don't want to be changed by the truth. And that's sometimes it's the hardest thing. It's not just picking on anyone, it's who we are also. So it's studying. We need to find out and be convicted what the Lord wants us to believe versus what man wants us to believe.
I think it's important too, another thing that just because someone says something, like even if they're like a pastor, I'm not like trying to like knock on pastors, but like if they say something during a sermon, you know, and you maybe feel kind of uneasy about it, you know, go and research it for yourself. Don't just take everything everyone says for truth, you know, go and research it, you know. One of our team members, Gavin, he had a sermon that we did on the last tour, and he was really uneasy about something, so he decided to go study it for himself, and that's what his sermon about. And so I think that's really good when people go and discover things for themselves.
Well, if we could all take a minute to skim through Proverbs chapter 11. Yeah, just a quick minute.
And just something to think about as you're scanning it. You know, what are some of the great blessings that come to people who are faithful and righteous as to those who are not faithful and are foolish? So we're going to be contrasting a little bit. So maybe after looking through a few verses or so, does anyone have any comments they would like to make about how the righteous and the wicked are being contrasted?
Well, as you could see, in one hand, the wicked people, they live in the present. They're not they're only concerned with what they see and with the immediate reward. And they think about themselves before others and selfish living. But in the other hand, the righteous are humble and honest and compassionate. As for the wicked people, and their way of seeing things, how they only see the present.
And something else to add to that, like she said, the wicked people, they live for the moment and they always make decisions in the moment, you know, and sometimes I struggle with this too. Sometimes, there's always that saying, you know, don't make a permanent decision for temporary feelings, and I feel like that's a lot of times what they do, because people, if they're put in a not so good situation, they're like, well, if I do it now, you know, or if say if a salesman is selling somebody something and he wants to kind of cheat them and get as much as he wants, it may be good for that time, but if he keeps doing that down the road, eventually it's going to catch up to him. So I think it's important to really think through what you're doing. Philosopher, let me see if I pronounce Cecilia Bach, has convincingly demonstrated how lying can be harmful for society. She writes, a society that whose members were unable to distinguish truthful messages from deceptive ones would collapse. Likewise, Augustine, as quoted in the introduction of Cecilia's book, noted that when regard for truth has been broken down or even slightly weakened, all things will remain doubtful. When we think of how powerful our words are, we must think also about lying, because most of the time, lies are told with words. You know, who hasn't felt that betrayal or like that sting when somebody either lies to you or you find out later that someone did lie to you? It really makes an impact on how you view that person, because it's like they lied to you and it really breaks down your trust with them. Some people are so used to lying that it doesn't even bother them anymore. Many people, though, do feel a sense of guilt or shame when they lie. you know, good for them because at least, you know, the Holy Spirit is still talking to them because they still feel guilty for it. But then it's also really sad to think about people who don't feel guilty for when they do it, because it just makes me, like, if you think about it, it's really sad because then they don't really have a conscience and they're not thinking about it, so they're just going to keep lying and lying. So just something to think about, you know, when was the last time you lied, you know, and how did you feel about it? So just ponder that.
As we have seen in Proverbs, so much of the instruction and teaching given has been presented by contrasting two types of people. The wise person does this and the foolish does that, and the godly man does this and the wicked man does that. Of course, in reality, there's often a bit of wisdom and foolishness in all of us. With the exception of Jesus, we are all sinners, and we fall short of the glory of God. Fortunately, we have a wonderful promise that comes in the next verse. Though we are sinners, by faith we can be justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ. In the end of it all humanity is going to be either in one of two camps: people who are going to be saved and people who are going to be lost. Now, if somebody could please read John 3:16.
Or recite it.
Oh, yeah. We could all recite it together. Okay.
So love the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
Well, what two options does all humanity face? It's either eternal life or death. And if everybody could take a quick minute to read Proverbs 13, 1 through 25, just skim through it. And while you're reading it, you could think of this question: how does this chapter contrast the experience and fate of the righteous with that of the wicked?
So does anyone have any comments they would like to make after reading through chapter 13 or a few of the verses that they read through? Autumn? Jacob?
In verse 5, it says, a righteous man hates lying, but the wicked man is loathsome and comes ashamed. I think it's interesting that righteous people, they hate lying, and so they're not going to do things that are going to put them in a situation where they need to lie. The wicked, they just kind of do whatever they want to, and then when it comes time, like when someone asks them about it, then they lie to cover it up because they don't want to look bad or anything like that. And I just think that's interesting, I guess.
Thank you.
In these verses, the wise are compared to a lasting lamp, while the wicked are compared to a lamp that will be put out. And that's in Proverbs 13:9. The wise person will enjoy the good fruit of his or her work, while the sinner will reap evil. And through their children, the wise have a future beyond themselves. The wicked instead will leave their wealth to strangers, even to the righteous. The point is that a life of faith and obedience to the Lord is better than a life of disobedience and folly.
Putting aside the big issue of the promise of eternal life, what are some of the immediate, you know, like day-to-day things that you have experienced through living a faith in Christ?
just some things that you have, you know, experienced, maybe like little things or larger things.
I think the whole chapter of Proverbs 13 is trying to tell us that if we really truly want to be happy, if we truly want to have real peace, if we want to have real wealth, and that is hope in our future, then we're going to choose a way that may not seem right to those around us, and that is to follow something that to us is invisible, to humanity is invisible, but by faith, that faith crosses that line of invisibility and grasped onto the reality of a loving, self-sacrificing God that wants to give us more than we can ever imagine.
I think it's important that when those times come where you do need to make those bigger decisions, whether obviously, and you know, in the end, many people were going to have to make the big decision either to stand up for what you believe in or to not stand up for what you believe in, you know, and like hide with the others. It's important that as like now, as we walk with God now, that we, you know, make good decisions in all like the little things, you know, stuff like either paying your tithe faithfully or, you know, when you're at work or for us students when we're at school, you know, to not cheat on tests or to not cheat during your work if you're working, you know. It's really important to make those good decisions for the little things so that way when it comes to the bigger things, your walk will be strong enough so it will be easier for you to have faith in God that He will take care of you. And then some things to hear to wrap it up a little bit. Ellen G. White in her Christ Object Lessons on page 312 and 313, she says, "It is not enough to make a profession of faith in Christ and have our names registered on the church roll. Whatever our profession, it amounts to nothing unless Christ is revealed in works of righteousness." And that's really something I thought about too. And like I'd heard this quote and I wasn't sure, so I went and I looked it up. There's this quote, you know, I think it perfectly goes along with this, you know. "Going to church doesn't make you a Christian any more than standing in your garage makes you a car." And also in The Desire of Ages, Ellen says, "Men may profess faith in the truth, but if it does not make them sincere, kind, patient, forbearing, heavenly-minded, it is a curse to its possessors. And through their influence, it is a curse to the world. The righteousness which Christ taught is conformity of heart and life to the revealed will of God." So some wrap-up questions we hope we can discuss. Why is this... So we kind of want to discuss how our decisions impact others for good or for evil after talking about all of this. You know, why is this an inescapable fact of life? Like, why do we always have to choose between good and evil? Or doing good things or choosing to do evil things? Thank you. Something else to, I think, one of the biggest things about deciding between good and evil, you know, it all goes back to Adam and Eve, you know. You know, this truth was first revealed in the story of the fall, where even to this day, the impact of Adam and Eve's choice is felt in each of our lives, and that's why we have to make either a good decision or a bad decision, because it all goes back to when Eve made that first decision and Adam to bite the apple. It might be tempting to try to measure the amount of good or bad our decisions may bring, but it's kind of risky to always think about, okay, if I do this, what bad things will happen? If I do this, what kind of good things will happen? You kind of like weigh the consequences, and then you make your choice. You know, why then, in the light of God and His law, must we choose to do what's right, regardless of what we fear the consequences might be?
Life is not all that it could be. Mm-hmm.
agree.
I think that at the end of it all, doing what's right is like you get a bigger reward at the end.
No, I do agree with you, because obviously, you know, if we make our good decisions, you know, up until, you know, Christ come, you know, it's almost like, you know, it's kind of like by your good decision, your good decisions, you know, you'll be able to hopefully, you know, go to heaven, because only, you know, only God knows your heart and only he knows the true intention of your decisions. But if we try and make those right decisions by the wisdom that God has given us or by wisdom that you ask him, you know, to help you with or give you, it's easier to make our decisions. Proverbs makes a sharp distinction between the righteous and the fool, as we have read. And from these verses, we learn what is right, we learn about what is right and wrong. Why, though, must we be very careful whom we judge as fools? On the other hand, how often have we been deceived by those whom we once thought were righteous? Something I thought about when I read this question, I think, like, I don't know why. I always parallel this either back to, like, my family or my friends, but how we, because sometimes, especially when we're younger, and some of you who have children or kids nowadays, you know, sometimes us as younger people, we think our parents are kind of foolish in a sense, because, you know, they don't really know what life is like now because they're chronologically inclined, and they don't understand how we work, and they're like, and we're like, you haven't been to school nowadays, you know, technology is this and that, you know, things are different now and things are back in the day. You know, a lot of the times, and then we end up going and making bad decisions that they advise us not to do just to learn and get right back where we were and to discover that what they were saying really was true, you know. There are some cases, you know, I just want to say just for us kids, you know, where we're like, you know, mom, like we try and explain things to them and they don't understand and we do something, you know, that kind of proves ourselves. I think that's also really good too. But I'm not saying to go against your parents' will because you always think you're right. But it's just that's just something I thought about when I read that question. So thank you for your time today, and we hope you have a happy Sabbath this afternoon. Let's all bow our heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for everything that you have given us. Please help us to make right decisions, you know, to ask you for wisdom and guidance in our life so when the big decisions come, we can make the right decisions so we can follow you and end up having everlasting life with you. Thank you that hopefully everyone has gotten here safely today and help them return safely home and help us all to have a good afternoon. In your name we pray, amen.
Thank you.
morning. Everyone is so happily chatting away. I hesitated to even get up here because it looked like so much fun. But we do need to get things started. We have a real special treat for everyone today. And I'm very excited to have Great Lakes Adventist Academy with us here. They've already presented a wonderful Sabbath school for us, and they've got a great church service planned for all of us. So welcome to all of you who are here with us, and welcome any of you watching online. I know we have quite a few. We have 9 live streaming right now. So welcome. We're glad that you're with us. We hope you can come in person sometime. Last year, Great Lakes was supposed to be here with us, and the winter weather made it so that they were not able to. So we're very pleased that the sun was shining this morning and they were able to come and be with us. So we're grateful for that. If you have a bulletin, take a peek in there. There is an announcement the pastor specifically wanted me to have you be aware of. There is a Pathfinder Bible experience, which they used to call it Bible Bowl, but it's not called that anymore. That is at 3:00 next Sabbath here, and all are invited to that. So think about that. I guess they're covering the book of Matthew, so it should be quite interesting. I see some heads shaking, so there's some Pathfinders who are ready for this. No, studying. Well, it should be a great thing. I need to bring the church into business session for just a moment. We have, for the purpose of a membership transfer into our church, we are transferring Ishmael, Veronica, and Gabe Sotos, wave your hand, and Jack and Meredith Stadden, are they here? Not today. We need a motion for them transferring in. Motion? Second? All in favor say amen.
Amen.
Welcome very much. We're grateful to have you be a part of our church. We have a few announcements that I'm going to turn into a prayer request. Stuart Wolcock had neck surgery and is having some complications with pain management, apparently. And so he is still in the hospital, so we are definitely going to keep Stuart in our prayers. Also, Mary Kay Bever, who's been in and out of the hospital. And our pastor's wife, Andrea Taylor, fell on the ice Thursday, 33 weeks pregnant. Kind of scary. She has a concussion, but she's doing well, and she's home resting. So thought you would want to keep her in your prayers as well. Will you bow your heads with me for prayer, and then we're going to turn this over to the Aerokhanas. Father, thank you for being with us this morning. Thank you for bringing the Aerokhanas to us safely this year. We thank you for the gorgeous weather outside that we've had. Thank you for all the blessings you've given each one of us. And Lord, as I spoke the prayer requests, we pray that you would be with each one of them mentioned, give them healing and rest. And we thank you for the Sabbath day. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for that warm welcome. We are excited to be here. We were all set to come last year, and then if you remember, there was quite a horrific snowstorm. It seems like the whole November through May was a horrific snowstorm last year. But we are thankful to be here, and the weather is wonderful, and we hope and pray that as we leave tonight, it continues to be that way. And then you guys can have all the snow that you desire. Here in Pawpaw. This morning, let's begin corporately. Let's begin our worship to God together as one family, all united under the head with Jesus, our brother, at our side. Let's worship the King this morning. I want to bring you to a story quickly from Zacchaeus. You all know who Zacchaeus, right? Is, right? Even the youngsters probably have heard the song, Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he, right? We know that story. So let me turn in my Bible really quick, my electronic Bible, to Zacchaeus 19. I want to share something with you really quickly. I'm going to start in verse 5, Zacchaeus 19:5. See, there was this crowd that had gathered, and Jesus, wherever he went, there was a crowd. He had to kind of go into the mountains to escape the crowds. And here he is, and there's this crowd, and there's this tax collector named Zacchaeus. And the Bible says he was a man of small stature. And so he couldn't see Jesus. He wanted to see what all the hubbub was about. And because he was short, he couldn't see him. So as we know, Zacchaeus climbed up in a tree. And Zacchaeus 19:5 says, and when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry down. Come down, for I must stay at your house today. So he hurried and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all grumbled. He has gone in to be in the house of a man who is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I restore it fourfold. And Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house. What would you do to see Jesus? What would you do? Would you climb a tree? Would you give to the poor? What would you do to be able to see Jesus? Today salvation has come to this house. Look at what an encounter with Zacchaeus did. Today salvation has come to this house, for he also is a son of Abraham. And verse 10, for the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. The Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. Now, as Christians, we're supposed to be like Jesus, right? Right there, I just said, from Zacchaeus, or from Luke 18, the story of Zacchaeus, Jesus himself said, for the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. If we're to be like Jesus, it's our duty to seek and save the lost. So that's my challenge for myself. You can apply that challenge to yourself if you want to. But let's join together in singing a very familiar hymn to our church, Seeking the Lost. Seeking the lost, yes, kindly entreating wanderers on the mountain astray. Come unto me, his message repeating, words of the Master speaking today. Going afar upon the mountain, bringing the wanderer back again, into the fold of my Redeemer, Jesus the Lamb for sinners. Just the ladies. All right, just the gentlemen, leading them forth in ways of salvation, showing the path to life evermore, going afar upon the mountain, bringing the wanderer back again. Into the fold of my Redeemer, Jesus the Lamb for sinners slain.
Thus I would go on missions of mercy, following Christ from day unto day, cheering the faint and raising the fallen, pointing the lost to Jesus the way.
Amen. Do you love the fact that you have the freedom to read your Bible? Amen. Do you cherish it? I have a question. When you sing these hymns of old and of new, some of them aren't that old, do you ever wonder where they came from? Do you ever wonder where the inspiration for the writing came from? More often than not, it comes right from Scripture. Seeking the Lost, story of Zacchaeus. The next song, I want to paint a picture for you before we sing it. And I just want to read to you. I want you to envision what the writer, John, was writing about, what he saw, what the Lord showed him in Revelation 22. The angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. Now use your imagination. Also, on either side of the river, the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit each month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be anything accursed, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. And the night will be no more. They will need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light. And they will reign forever and ever. Amen. As a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, we believe in the Advent, in the second coming of Christ, who will come to redeem. And when he does, shall we gather at the river.
Trod with its crystal tide forever flowing from the throne of God. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows. Pray, we our spirits will deliver and provide a Roman crown. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the the shining river. Soon our pilgrimage will cease. Soon our happy hearts will quiver with the melody of peace. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful, the beautiful.
Great to be here today. I want to read you guys from Psalms 46, a passage here. All right. God is our refuge and strength and our ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar, kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice, the earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth, and makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear and burns the shields with fire. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. So even with all those things going on, it says such a simple thing, and it's be still and know that I am God. And it's such a powerful thing. If you ever have just sat and just thought about God, or you thought and just prayed and like just totally like took out all your other distractions and think about him, being still and knowing God is such a powerful thing. And I just wanted to welcome you guys here on this Sabbath. And it's awesome, a Sabbath. We always say, happy Sabbath. How often do people get to say, happy New Year, once a year? Say, happy birthday, once a year, unless it's like to a bunch of people, And then, Merry Christmas. But we have happy Sabbath. Every week, we have something to be happy about. It's like a holiday for us every single week. And so I just wanted to welcome you guys here this Sabbath.
Please stand for opening prayer. Please bow your heads. Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you that we're here together to worship you. And please be with the sermons and everyone and help them to get a blessing. Amen.
Please remain standing. Gotcha. Let's sing our opening hymn together. Hymn number 309. 309, I surrender all. As we worship God together, let's surrender everything to him. All of our thoughts, all of our cares, all of our worries, surrender that to God. As you sing this song, pray it to him. Ask for the Lord to fill you. As we worship him this morning, let's surrender all to Jesus.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence day. I surrender all.
Jesus, I surrender. Now I feel the sacred flame. Oh, the joy of salvation. Glory, glory to His name. I surrender all. I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior.
Happy Sabbath. All right, it's now time for the call for offering. So I'm going to call for the offering. Our offering this morning goes to the Good News Farm located at Gla, which is where we're from. And I actually worked there for a little while last year. It was pretty cool. But the farm grows local veganic produce for the academy. Veganic produce is produce which is grown not only without the use of pesticides, but without any animal fertilizers and stuff. So the farm produces a source of much-needed income for the students there, a lot of them, and it's really helpful for those who can't necessarily work off as much as they need to and stuff. But the goal of the farm work program is to make it possible for students to work their way through the academy while learning how to do natural farming. During 2014, the farm provided work opportunities for 20 to 25 students per semester, and sold over $250,000 of veganic produce through farm boxes and to such retail vendors as Whole Foods Market and such. Your donations this morning will continue to help provide the farm with needed capital and operating funding. All the loose offerings today will be designated for the Good News Farm. Large offerings should be put into a tithe envelope and marked as the Good News Farm. Future donations may also be made the same way on any Sabbath. Simply put the offering into the tithe envelope and mark it as the Good News Farm and put it into your church offering plate. Nice and easy. The money that you donate will be used to open the way for more students to be able to afford quality Christian education. Will the deacons please stand? All right. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for today. Thank you that we're able to be here on this wonderful Sabbath day. Be with us now as we're about to collect the offering. Bless it and the people who offer it. Help them to be able to offer much more in the future as well. Bless those and help this money to do well for us and for your work. In your name, amen.
Thank you. Hello. Okay. It is now time for children's stories, so can the kids please come up? Right here on the stage. Start say hi and gingers. So this began at GLA. I was this one day, a friend and I, let's call him, wasn't it Benny? We're gonna call him Benny. And we were working that day, and to get around, we drive golf carts. And this day it was snowing and it was really icy out. So he, you know, he's a very reckless driver. And as we were going throughout doing our job, we went from the gym and we went to the girls' dorm, and you know, he decided, you know, let's go full speed. All right, we're gonna go from the girls' dorm to the boys' dorm. Okay, he's going full speed, about 10 miles per hour. And we're going down. And, you know, we feel the wind, and it's just, you know, this feeling. We're going, and, but, like, for some reason, I don't know what happened. He's just like, which way we go, we're going to go. And I'm like, well, there's only one way. And he's like, no, let's go right. I'm like, then let's just go forward. No, let's go right. No, let's go forward. And we start arguing on the golf cart. And we're just looking at each other. We're not even paying attention to where we're going. And as we're going, there are benches in center campus, metal benches. And so we're not paying attention, we're going full speed. And next thing you know, we both look at each other, we look up, and we're screaming like little girls. And we see, and next thing you know, he presses the brake, we're going in circles, and you know, we hit the bench, and he flies out, I fly out, and you know, and so, for what I get from this, you know, you guys are young. And, you know, we decide to make decisions. You know, we talk about it, but you want to make decisions, you know, right from wrong. And you know that. And as kids, you know, listen to your parents, you know, and make good choices. So, yeah, and would anyone like to pray?
Let's bow our heads. Dear Jesus, thank you for your love for us, Lord, and thank you for giving us this day that we can come and worship you. I ask that you please help these kids to obey their parents and to make great decisions. Please inspire them on what to do. Thank you, Lord, in your name, amen.
And as you go up, please grab a cup as you're heading to your seat. Thank you.
ask that all of us who can kneel, please kneel with me for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I want to thank you so much for the Sabbath day that you've given us. I want to thank you that the sun is shining and that we're all here in the house of worship. I want to especially lift up Ashton and Nathan as they are going to deliver your word. I pray that you speak through them, and I pray for each and every one of us that is in here today, Lord, and I pray that we may gain a blessing, and I pray for everyone that also couldn't make it today, and we love you so much, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who have further a land called rescue.
Oh. Our first scripture reading is found in Psalms 37, verse 4. Psalms 37, verse 4. Psalms 37, verse 4. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. I'm so glad we all get to be here this morning. I'm not a big fan of the cold weather because I'm definitely from the South, so the snow is just not my thing. So my name is Ashton Kennedy, and I am a senior this year, and I've been on the Aerokhanas team for 3 years. And this is, I think this is my third or my fourth sermon that I've done so far, but I'm a bit nervous, so let's pray before we begin. Yeah, bow your heads with me. Okay. And dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this Saturday that we all get to come together and worship you. And I ask you to help me give a blessing to all these people and just calm my nerves so that I do a good job. In your name I pray, amen. So, as we all know, sometimes things don't go as we plan in life. We hit bumps and curves and roundabouts that we didn't plan on. We might plan for one thing, but God's plan is another. Sometimes the view that we have isn't the view that he has. As humans, we want to plan for our lives and how we want it to go or how we think it should go. We try to plan our schedules day by day, but depending on ourselves isn't going to get us where we need to go. I went on a plane for the first time by myself, actually, this last home leave. And because I had flown before, not very many times, but this time my dad was like, okay, you're gonna fly by yourself back to school. I was like, what? And when I went to go to the plane, every bad thought was running through my head. Like, what if I'm going to be late? What if I don't have the right ticket? What if they don't think my photo looks like my ID? Like, it was like, what happens if the plane crashes? What's my exit plan? Like, it was so scary. But after I did it, I was okay afterwards. But putting my life in the hands of the pilot made me nervous because I didn't know him. And it's crazy that, like, when I walked on the plane, I realized all these people who've never met the pilot before trust him to get them to their destination safely, no questions asked. If we are able to trust a pilot that we have never met before, why sometimes is it so hard for us to trust the ultimate pilot who controls our final destination? So many times we question his plans for us and wonder if it's really what we want. But truth is, he knows what we really truly want. And if we could go to Psalms 37:4. Where it says, delight yourselves also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. So I don't know how many of you have been on a plane, but for those of you who haven't, you sit down and the flight attendant goes through all the safety instructions and things to do in case of an emergency, like the oxygen masks and the flotation devices. And they also warn you that turbulence may occur depending on the weather we encounter along the way to our destination. And it's just like God. He tells us that there's going to be turbulence along the way, and we're going to encounter rough patches, that it's not going to be perfectly smooth. It's not going to be a perfectly smooth flight the whole way. But in case of an emergency, he left us our instructions manual, just like on the plane. He left us the Bible that we can pull out and use at any time we need it. And it gives us all the answers to every scenario or any kind of turbulence, if you may, that we will go through. What if the flight attendant came out and was like, so we will be flying today, and if something goes wrong, it's every man for himself. God doesn't do that to us. He doesn't expect us to figure things out on our own. He expects us to depend on him for what we need. When I was on the plane, I was inspired to, like, I was realizing all these people on the plane. And I found this story about a plane that landed. Most of you probably remember it happening, but I'm going to read the story anyways. The Airbus 320 took off from LaGuardia bound for Charlotte in North Carolina at 3:26 p.m. A mere 30 to 45 seconds after takeoff, there was a bang and the aircraft shook, believed to have been caused by its striking a flock of geese. The pilot reported to air traffic control that he was experiencing engine problems and requested to return to ground. The nearest identified airport was in New Jersey, but when it became clear he could not make it, the pilot prepared for a crash landing on the Hudson. "Brace yourselves for impact," he told the passengers. Seconds later, the plane struck the Hudson on a line with 48th Street in Midtown Manhattan, turning a stretch of waterway normally populated by tourists, enjoying a waterside view of the skyscrapers, into an astonishing fight for survival. Eyewitnesses reported seeing a splash and the plane coming to an immediate stop. It looked so controlled that some witnesses mistook it for the landing of a seaplane. "I just thought, why is it so low?" And splash, it hit the water, said one witness. Jeff, one of the passengers, said that after takeoff, they had heard a bang and the plane filled with smoke from the left engine. "It was pretty scary. We got out by the luck of God. I take my hat off to the pilot. It was incredible we all made it off alive," he said. The pilot of U.S. Airways jet managed to avoid disaster and save the lives of all 155 people on board his stricken plane when he ditched into the icy waters of the Hudson River moments after taking off from New York's LaGuardia Airport. The extraordinary escape was immediately dubbed the Miracle on the Hudson. Flight 1549 was carrying 148 passengers, including a baby, 5 crew, and 2 pilots, and all of them escaped. The captain, named Chesley Sullenberger, had 29 years of experience with commercial airlines and was a former U.S. Air Force fighter pilot. With both his twin engines in trouble, one apparently on fire, and with the nearest airport out of range, he calmly brought the plane to land on the river on the west side of Manhattan. Sullenberger then helped passengers escape to rescue boats and twice walked the length of the passenger cabin inside the sinking jet to check that everyone had gotten out safely before escaping himself. "We have had a miracle on 34th Street. Now we have a miracle on the Hudson," the governor of New York, David Patterson, said. Another passenger, Alberto Pinero, said, "I want to thank you to that pilot. It was as good a landing as you can make in a river." He said that passengers had begun praying as it came in low over the river, but all remained calm. One puzzle, though, is why both engines cut out. The left engine appeared to have caught fire, but pilots are usually able to bring a plane into an emergency landing with just one engine working. It was described by member Katie Higgins as the most successful ditching in aviation history. As you can see, these people trusted their pilot to get them to safety. No questions asked. I'm sure the panic of the situation frightened them all, but they had to leave it in the hands of the pilot because they knew that's what was best, because he was the one who had the experience. He knew what he was doing and how to handle the situation. It's the same with God. He knows what he's doing, and he's the one with the experience. He's our pilot and our captain. Now, I'm sure that if you were on a plane and something did go wrong and you weren't paying attention, like a lot of people I realize don't when the flight attendant is giving the instructions, but I can almost bet that if something did go wrong, you'd have those safety instructions in the back of your seat out in a flash. I know I would. I would want to know exactly what to do, especially if my life depended on it. But why is it when God gives us our safety manual, when we're going through a hard time or crisis, we seem to turn to everything but that? We depend on everything around us, but not the one thing that could actually help us. God gives us the Bible to teach us, to help us, and to guide us through the life we should be living. But we tend to turn to worldly things to help us. But we need to realize that planes or pilots in our world are not going to be the ones to take us where we're really going, and that's heaven. In knowing everything about our pilot and him knowing everything about us, there should be no reason not to trust him because with him as our pilot, nothing can bring our plane down. So today I leave you with one question. When our pilot asks us to board, are you going to be on the right flight?
Thank you.
hear me when I call. You are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light.
Whom shall I fear?
You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still,
whom shall I fear?
I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. My strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You crush the enemy, yours is the victory. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hand. I'm holding on to your promises.
You are faithful.
I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Our second memory reading, scripture reading for today is Exodus 32:29. And it says, then Moses said, consecrate yourselves today to the Lord, that he may bestow on you a blessing this day, for every man has opposite his son and his brother.
Thank you. Good morning. Happy Sabbath, everyone. So first off, I'd like to start with a quick prayer. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the sun outside. Please bless the words that I have to speak today. And thank you that we can all be here and worshiping you today. Please open our hearts. Please help us to learn something new this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So my name is Nathan Griswold. And my family were missionaries in Thailand for 10 years. And I've just been back here in the States for 2.5 years. So I was out there for quite a while. And We moved around a lot in Thailand, but the last place that we moved to was, we were living there for 5 years, so like half of the time. And the story of how we got the house and stuff and is a whole different story. But my dad, what he was doing there in Thailand is he was in charge of the Buddhist study center, and there's 5 different world religion study centers that our conference has done and set up in the world. And he studied a little bit about Buddhism and how to reach out to those the Buddhist people and how to like build bridges and reach out to them and use some of what they're used to and stuff and be able to like help them. When we moved to this place in Thailand, after about a couple months there at the house, we were having these problems with snakes, and like, I don't know if you guys like snakes, but my family aren't real fans, especially my mom. My mom really hates snakes. And there are so many different kinds of snakes in Thailand. There's poisonous snakes, there's pythons, there's green vipers, there's cobras, there's king cobras, lots of different kinds of cobras. And yeah, it was not a good thing for my mom because she would freak out and she'd be like, I don't want you guys, she didn't want our children going out and playing in certain places because she was afraid they were going to get bit by snakes. And it was really real because I was climbing a tree one day, and I was almost at the top of the tree, and I grabbed for a limb, and I came face to face with the green viper. And it was like a foot away from my face. It was pretty creepy. And so I quickly dropped to the ground. And then another time, my dad was preparing a sermon or like a talk for one of his meetings he was going to give. And he was sitting under this coconut tree. And all of a sudden, this green viper drops out from the tree right next to him and just like kind of like slithers away. And he was like, what is going on? These snakes are just falling out of the tree. And so we were wondering what's going on. Another time, I was sitting outside and barefoot because I was a little kid and I like being barefoot, it's comfortable. And anyway, and I was doing homework outside and I felt this thing tickling my foot and I swatted at it because I thought it was a mosquito or a fly. And I looked down and there's this baby green viper just like slithering away and he had just crawled across my foot. I was just kind of like creeped out because green baby vipers, they don't control their venom, so they're like a lot more dangerous than like their parents and stuff. So I was like, this is not cool. And then another time we were playing like some sports out on our lawn there, and my mom, she was barefoot, and she stepped right on the head of, I'm not sure what kind of snake it was. It was a poisonous snake, quite poisonous. And she just stepped on the head. And she was like, she was so scared, but she didn't want to take her foot off of the snake because she was afraid it was going to bite her. And so she just stood there while we got a hoe or like a shovel and killed the snake there. But yeah, it was pretty creepy. And so all these things were happiness. And there's so many other stories I could talk about, like these snakes. And we were thinking, what is going on? Because our neighbors, they weren't having these problems. It was just us, our family. And these snakes were distracting us from the work my parents were wanting to do. And so we prayed about this. We were like, God, what's going on? Why are we getting, attacked by these snakes? I feel like it's a spiritual problem. I feel like Satan is trying to attack our family to try to distract us from the work we have to do. And so we prayed about it, and then all of a sudden my dad, he had this thought come into his head. It's like, we haven't surrendered our whole property here to God. And my family were like, what do you mean? What do you mean, Dad? And he said, okay, so quick background check. Thailand is very strong Buddhist, and most of the homes there, they have this little like shrine. It's called like a spirit house, and it's like a little tiny house that's like on you know, like a pillar. And the people, like the Buddhists, they'll go and they'll put like food and like soda or whatever to the, and they'll set it there, and they believe the spirits like live and reside in these little houses. And we had three of them in the corner, our landlords, because we were renting the property there. Our landlords had three of these little houses in the corner of our property. And we were, you know, when we moved there, we're like, it's okay, it's fine, we can, you know, work around this. But we realized that this was a stronghold for Satan. And so we prayed about it. We didn't want to come across too strong to our landlords to, you know, to kind of push them away from wanting to learn more about God. But we knew that we had to act on something, and so we, after praying, and my dad found a couple Bible verses in the Bible to share with them, and so that they would understand where we're coming from. And so my dad went to the landlords, and he talked to them, and they decided to work out to put up a fence around the spirit house, so it's kind of apart from our house there. And so once we stuck this fence around the spirit house, all the snakes went away. And we hardly ever saw snakes. I mean, once in a while we see these like little rat snakes or just, you know, different, not very harmless snakes. But one time I was walking past the fence there, and I saw this snake crawling on the fence, and I was like, you know what? They're probably all in there right there. But anyway, so once we were able to surrender our property 100% to God, he was able to protect us. He was able to push aside Satan and his distractions he was sending to our family through these snakes. And by stepping out in faith and surrendering our property to God, our landlords saw our commitment to God, and they wanted to learn more. And our landlady, after a couple months, she actually got baptized, which was really neat. It was really cool. Okay, so now I want you guys to think in your mind about the story of Joseph. It's in the last quarter of Genesis. This guy, he grew up, you know, he was the favorite of his family. His dad loved him so much, he was probably pretty spoiled. He got the best of everything. And then all of a sudden, one day, he gets sold. His brothers sell him to these slave traders from Egypt. And he finds himself on his way to Egypt. And I don't know what you guys would feel like or like what he felt like, but for me, I'd be like devastated. He's probably crying. He's probably having such a hard time with this that it was overwhelming for him. But he decided to give his life to God. He decided to consecrate his whole entire life to God, and he said, "God, take this and use it for your good." And when he got to Egypt, he worked for this guy named Potiphar, and God blessed him so much that he got to the top, right under Potiphar. He was the head of the servants, and God used him and blessed every single thing that Joseph did. And then he gets sent to prison for something that he didn't do. And I would have been so upset about this. I would have been, "God, why are you doing this to me? You know, you've been blessing me this whole time, and now I'm in prison." Joseph decided not to let it discourage him. He was at prison, and he surrendered his life again, and he was able to do so much in the prison. He was blessed. The guards, I'm sure, were like really surprised because he was, you know, such a great guy. And then afterwards, after a couple years, he ends up getting out of prison, and he goes straight to the top. He goes right under the Pharaoh himself, and he is blessed, and everything that he does is blessed. And this is because he surrendered 100% to God, and he consecrated himself to God. I'm not sure how many of you guys got to go to our passion play last night at the Howard, but I was Judas, and I just want to kind of look at Judas's life and compare it to Joseph's life. Judas was so, he wanted total control. He didn't want to surrender anything to God. He had this whole plan that he was going to have Jesus become king, and he was going to be the next one underneath him. And this plan didn't work out, obviously. And he ends up killing himself, hanging himself. And it's so different from Joseph's life, where Joseph surrendered 100% to God. And Judas, he wanted total control. And it says in Desires of Ages, it talks about, there's a whole chapter on Judas. It's chapter 76. But anyway, Ellen White says that Judas almost changed when he was at the Passover Supper, or the Last Supper. He, during the foot washing, he almost surrendered to God. He almost gave up. He almost said, hey, God, take this. Take my plans. Take everything and let you lead. But he didn't. He let his pride get in the way. And he ended up committing suicide. These two guys, such different outcomes, you know. It's crazy what surrendering your life to God can do and what can happen after that. So what are some of the, there's so many different ways, some of the ways why we don't feel like giving 100% to God. There's one way is because we feel like we want to be in control of our own life. We don't want to surrender it to God because we like, you know, we're human. We like to be in control of stuff. And another one is trust issues. We might not feel like we can trust God with 100% of us. We want to keep, you know, let me keep 75, let me keep 25%, let me give 75% to God. It's okay, you know, it's just 25%. We just don't want to trust him with some of these things. Another thing is loss of what you desire. You might not want to let go of something. It might be such a stronghold in your life that it's just too difficult to you know, give, and it's something that you desire. Another thing is stepping out of your comfort zone. Sometimes giving 100% to God, you have to step out of your comfort zone. And we like being in our comfort zone. You know, this is comfortable for us. We don't want to step out, but you know, we can't let God bless us if we don't step out of our comfort zone and, you know, give 100% to God. Another way why we feel like we can't give 100% to God is we're embarrassed of what our friends or our family may think. Sometimes it's very difficult. You know, peer pressure is strong, and it's sometimes hard to say, hey, you know, to your friend, I'm surrendering my life to God. I'm giving up this thing that we, you know, do together or whatever, because I don't feel like it's right, and I'm surrendering it to God. And that's, you know, that's very difficult. What are some of the ways we can be able to surrender 100% to God? The first thing is you have to realize, you have to understand what area, you have to look and see what area in your life needs surrendering to God. That's often hard to do because there's many areas in our life that we need to surrender to God. But you got to let it go. You got to let God take it from you. All you have to do is you have to let it go to God. And he's standing right there. He wants to take this burden off of you. He wants to remove it, and he wants to use that to bless you and so that you can bless others. I want to challenge you guys today to surrender 100% to God. Surrender your will to control in your own life. Let him control in your own life. Give your, if you have trust issues, if you're not sure if you can trust God, give that to God. Let God lead. If you are struggling coming out of your comfort zone and letting God take that, God can help you out of your comfort zone. If you're embarrassed of your family or friends, you know, tell them this. Just go ahead, tell them that I'm going to give 100% to God. This is what I feel called to do. Let him lead in your life. Let him use you and bless you by giving 100% to him. Thank you.
You know, God is so amazing, and he works in such beautiful ways. Who could tell me what our opening hymn was? I Surrender All. And God spoke to Nathan. Nathan didn't know that was our opening song. Most of the time, these guys don't even know until I tell them, like, right before we do it. But God wanted you to hear, I don't know who, maybe it's me. One of us, all of us, needed to hear that today I need to surrender all. I need to surrender all to God. I need to surrender my everything, my health, my finances, my family, my dogs, if you're me, I have eight. You have to surrender everything to Him. Do you feel like the Lord spoke to you today? Was the Spirit of God in this place? Amen, I agree. And He was here because we invited Him. And I'm just so proud to be a part of something like that, a church where God is alive. And I, myself, am a product of Christian education. I can't tell you where I'd be if I wasn't. But I wouldn't be here. I know that. Christian education has meant so much in my life. All of my years have been... There's not been a year since I was six that I wasn't part of a school that had an Adventist name. And I'm 32. And that's a testament to how wonderful and merciful God is. I'm a huge believer in Christian education. I'm so thankful to God that I get to work in a place where Christian education is important. And we get to see young people like these Aerokhanas blossom and flourish. And we're hoping that by being in our Christian schools, they're learning to surrender all to God. What's amazing is once we do, once we put it all at the foot of the cross, we're all equal. Every one of us mean the same at the foot of the cross. We find our value in Jesus Christ. Our closing hymn today is hymn number 163. Please join with us standing at the cross, hymn number 163. Let's take this one a little faster.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would He devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? Myself away, 'tis all that I
For prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for this Sabbath day and that we're able to come here and worship you. As Nathan said, help us to give all of our lives to you, and as Ashton said, help us to be on the right plane when the time comes. Be with us as we go throughout the rest of the week, and help us to give ourselves to you every day. In your name, amen. You may be seated.